This is the Samsung S23 FE, a smartphone that challenges the very definition of exceptional value and quality. And in this in-depth review, and after using this phone for 2 weeks, I have discovered some really great things about the phone, like its battery performance, the cameras, and the display. So, what's the problem? Is it the Exynos 2200 chipset? Well, let's find out. Now, I'm gonna unconventionally start off this review by letting you know the current price of the phone. As of the recording of this video, the exact variant is going for 2,699 ringgit. Now, considering that is quite an attractive price point. So with that figure in mind, let's dive in into this in-depth review. So Samsung definitely nailed the basics of a great smartphone with an overall design and build quality. And that is something that I really appreciated when I use the phone daily. Because the phone feels comfortable in the hand thanks to its part glossy finish, which is paired with the matte sides and in turn makes the phone less slippery compared to other smartphones with a similar aesthetic and build quality. But the only thing that I would probably slightly nitpick is the weight of the phone and of course the thicker sides too. Because if you prefer a lighter or a thinner smartphone, then this might not be the right choice for you. Now, despite having its reasonably sized battery, which I'll discuss more later, I suspect the glass back to contribute significantly for the phone's overall weight. Now, that is actually not a huge deal because that is to be expected for a sort of a premium feel to the phone. But what I can say is that when I was using the phone daily, it has never been an issue for me, especially with the added assurance of an IP68 rating. And also noteworthy is the inclusion of Type-C Gen 3.2 port, offering much faster speeds than most phones within the same price bracket, and yes, that includes the iPhone 15 series too. Now, while the design and build quality felt like a flagship, but when you start looking at the display though, here's where you start to realize, it's not a flagship. And this is not because of the refresh rate, as it still has 120Hz refresh rate and of course the great quality of the dynamic AMOLED 2x display, but the obvious non-flagship trait is the bezels all at the sides. Other than that, the screen's durability is not as great as the flagship S23 since this FE variant comes with Corning Gorilla Glass 5 instead of Corning Gorilla Glass Victus 2. So I would advise for you to put on a case just for the sake of protecting the screen. However, if you feel like you still want to take the risk by using the phone without a case though, here's where Guard Genius would be the best bet for you, who is the sponsor of this video, as they have the Smart Guard Protection Plan that protects you from accidental screen cracks from 269 ringgit for 12 months. And suppose you ever need to do any repairs on the Samsung S23 FE, in that case, they'll be using genuine Samsung parts, tools, training, and diagnostic resources to perform various repairs, including out-of-warranty repairs. They have also committed to contributing SDG 12, which is United Nations Sustainable Development Goal 12, to have a more sustainable future. So by going with their services, you can reduce e-waste, conserve resources, to have a more sustainable and equitable world. So head to the link down below for more info on Guard Genius, and thank you Guard Genius for sponsoring this video. So other than the thicker bezels and the screen durability, that is the only compromise here. Because beyond that, you are presented with a high quality 6.4-inch FHD Plus display and quite a high 1450 nits of peak brightness. Now at this level of brightness, it is particularly impressive. So bright that you think that your screen has been sipping on liquid sunshine. And you'll notice it even more when viewing HDR content, even on apps like YouTube. And as for Netflix, it has Widevine L1 playback specification with HDR10 support as well. So yeah, having a really bright screen for the price also means that the visibility isn't compromised when using the phone outdoor in daylight, which I find the screen to be extremely useful, especially taking photos in a very bright daylight, which brings me to the next topic, which is the performance of the cameras. Now, as mentioned and shown in my first impressions video, when I compared this phone against the S23 side by side, besides the slightly difference in color, which you can adjust the saturation in post if you really need to, you are indeed looking at a close to a flagship level quality photos on the phone, especially during the day. Now, the ultra-wide lenses perform great with no signs of a fisheye or a barrel distortion kind of effect. The edges tend to be a tiny bit soft, but that is only if you pixel peak really close, because all in all, you're looking at a great ultra-wide camera during the day. And it's always great when smartphones keep its color reproduction identical when you switch from the ultra-wide lens to the main lenses, and that is the case over here, where on these main lenses, you can really see the 50-megapixel camera really shine. Then the 3x dedicated optical zoom also performed really well, although at only 8 megapixel as seen in these daytime shots. Portrait mode for plants or flowers and human subjects performed really great too, even some high amounts of backlighting, and it also did a really great job for pets too. Now, as expected, the phone did a really good job on the selfie photos, especially on the portrait selfie pictures, with amazing dynamic range and the blurred background and amazing age detection too. However, at night, you will start seeing the ultra-wide lenses slightly degrading, where the images can be a bit washed out unless you're really stable when taking photos at night using the ultra-wide cameras. Because if you're stable when taking the shots, the balance of both is really great and of course the overall image quality. Now, like the daytime shots, the main lenses at night performed exceptionally well. Not only were they sharp, but once again, the balance of the highlights and shadows were lovely with no noticeable noise in the darker areas of the image. And the 8-megapixel telephoto lens or the 3x zoom image was decent, not the best at night, but I would pass off it as decent, especially if your hands are steady. However, Samsung's image processing works wonders when it comes to the portrait mode shots even at night, with great subject to background blur and age detection. Now, to my surprise, the nighttime selfie did perform pretty great, especially with a not so high megapixel count. Now, as long as you have any source of light, you are good to go, whether or not it's for the regular or the portrait selfie images. Now, as for video, the ultra-wide lens quality was really nice and so was the image stabilization as well, and the same can be said for the main lenses too. Then the video for the front camera did very well, making it a perfect vlogging phone. And speaking of vlogging, here is an audio recording test for you to hear how it sounds.
Alright, so this is a video audio recording test using the front camera for the 4K 30 frames per second. The overall dynamic range seems to be pretty decent. The skies does not overly expose like how the non-flagship smartphones are, so that is good. So this is an audio recording test. Test 1, 2.
Now once again, the video footage for the main lenses was way superior compared to the ultra-wide lenses when using it at night. So I would recommend just using the main lenses all the way, even for its image stabilization. Then the nighttime footage for the front camera was decent, but once again, I would recommend looking for as much light as possible to get the utmost best quality. So with all of this, do let me know what you think of the overall camera's performance. Let me know in the comment section below, and if you guys are enjoying this video, a nice big thumbs up would be very much appreciated, and a subscription would be lovely too, as this kind of videos is not so easy to do. So thank you very much in advance. Now, the biggest complaint from almost every reviewer is the fact that it uses the Exynos 2200 chipset. Oh, for God's sake, so what? I don't get what the problem is, because it doesn't get hot enough to fry an egg, and it performs adequately well during general use or even more of a performance needs, where I did not see any issue over here. Now, gaming on Genshin Impact was really great, where I'll put the exact settings on the screen for your reference, and the device did maintain a cool temperature throughout, where it only became slightly warmer to the touch when I was updating the software and during taking photos in a very harsh daylight, but that is to be expected since our Malaysian weather is hot haze. Sometimes it rains. Now, another thing worth mentioning is the fact there are two performance profiles under the battery settings, which is standard and light. So you can toggle accordingly to how and when you use the phone. And I personally think that this flexibility is great, which I always left it at standard. And in case you did not know, that this Exynos 2200 4nm chipset, which a lot of people complains about, does support hardware-enabled ray tracing too, which does make the chipset more future-proof, especially for gaming. So yeah, besides gaming, I have absolutely no issues using the phone daily, and as of the recording of this video, the phone was at One UI version 5.1 on the latest security patch on the 1st of October. Then the phone has support for DeX mode and tons of customization, including the GoodLock customization app, and Samsung promises 4 years of software updates and 5 years of security updates on the phone. Again, another future-proofing done over here. And speaking of the number 5, yes, this phone has support for 5G, where the connection was great, Wi-Fi speeds were great with this Wi-Fi 6E modem on the phone, and their Samsung Pay support too. So with this thickness of the phone, at first glance, I thought that this would come with a huge 5000 mAh of battery inside, but it came with 4500 mAh instead. Now that initially concerned me, but the good news is that the battery life using the phone daily proved to be quite an impressive, at an average close to 6 hours and 11 minutes of screen on time, and close to about 8 hours of overall use when I was at 10% battery with dark mode turned on. And knowing the fact that this phone has wireless charging, again for this price factor, it is very much appreciated. But I would like to know, at this point in time, in year 2023, how important is wireless charging for you? Let's discuss at our Discord community page, which I'll link it down in the description below. So in a world of smartphones where price often dictates expectations, this Samsung S23 FE is a device that demands a double take. Its design is a delight, and the display shines even under the glare of a midday sun. Now yes, there are some quirks on the cameras at night, but for the price that it offers, it is indeed not a big deal. And while the Exynos 2200 chipset stirs up debates, it remains cool under a pressure of performance. But check out this video over here for a device that will complement your experience with a phone even better.